Okay, hello everyone. Thank you so much for joining us in this breakout session for gene therapy and editing. We have two amazing speakers today. We're gonna start with Dr. Albert Zimmer. He's a chief scientific officer at Homology Medicines. It's a company that pushes gene editing and therapy technologies into novel treatment for patients of rare disease. Dr. Zimmer has more than 20 years of experience bridging together human genetics and pharmaceutical research and development. And we very much look forward to hearing what he has to say about gene therapy. Thank you, Albert.
Okay, thank you, Angie. And it's really, it's a pleasure to be able to speak to everyone today virtually. So I am going to go ahead and share my presentation and go through. And I think what we were going to do is hold questions until the end of both talks that we can then answer as we go through. So again, thank you for this opportunity to speak at this virtual conference. As Angie had alluded to, my name is Albert Zimmer, and I'm the Chief Scientific Officer at Homology Medicines. I'm going to walk through just a little bit about gene therapy. I'll introduce a little bit about gene editing, but I know Dr. Ecker is going to go into more detail on that. And then I'm really going to walk through how we can think about AAVs as a delivery vehicle for gene therapy as potential treatments for disorders of the CNS and inclusive of Grand-1. Because we are a publicly traded company, I put this forward as I will be talking a little bit about one of the programs that we have in our pipeline. So if there are any questions about Homology Medicines, feel free to go to our most recent SEC documents. So I'd like to start with really defining how we look at gene therapy versus gene editing and how
Dr.
both of them.
Real quick, we don't see your slides yet. Could you make sure to share
them? Oh, you don't? Oh.
Nope, not yet.
Okay, hold on.
Thank you.
Okay, excellent. So I'd like to start with really defining how we think about gene therapy and gene editing and how both of them can be thought about as genetic medicines approaches to treat and potentially cure. I know that's a big word, but a lot of us that are in that field are really striving for that. We're not there yet, but really trying to utilize these technologies to approach diseases where we know what the cause of the disease is at the genetic level. I like to use it as really a very high level definition, whereas gene therapy, think about it as adding a functional copy of the gene. And so we can take a gene copy, we can insert it through a delivery approach with gene therapy into a cell, and then that cell can go ahead and make that appropriate protein. Works really well for disorders where perhaps that functional copy of the gene is missing, or even if there is some protein there, perhaps you can overexpress it. The thing about gene therapy is it expresses as what's called an episome. I'll show a brief pictorial of what I mean by that. But basically what we do is we can engineer these so that they sit inside the workhorse of the cell, which is the nucleus, and then they will drive that expression, but they don't necessarily integrate at high levels into the genome. And so because of that, it's most suitable for organs that slowly or don't divide at all. And the reason being is because it doesn't fully integrate into the genome. Each time a cell divides, you start to lose those copies. So it's a potential for one-time treatment, but you have to be very careful about the kind of cells that are the target cells for a particular disease, because you don't want them dividing too rapidly. Otherwise, you can have an effect, and then that effect can wane over time. Gene editing is basically a way to insert either a functional gene or insert into the DNA a way to correct a particular mutation. And the easiest way that I think about these two is that for gene editing, you are integrating into the genome. Now, this would be considered what's called the somatic genome. So we're going into cells that are in your body, not trying to integrate into cells that are going to be passed down to future generations, but just in the cells of the person being treated. And the nice thing about editing is because it integrates into the genome of the cell, those cells can go ahead and divide, because once you make that correction in the DNA, each time that cell divides, the daughter cells, if you will continue to harbor that change and that effect. And so again, this is a potential for a one-time treatment. So that's really in a high level a way to distinguish between gene therapy and gene editing. The rest of the talk, I'm going to focus more on gene therapy, but add in a little bit around gene editing, and then we'll turn it over to Dr. Eckerell to take us through the gene editing approaches. So we have a platform, but it's very similar to other platforms in that we are using what are called adeno-associated viruses, and these are called commonly referred to as AAVs. And we had actually discovered 15 of these naturally occurring, meaning that our founder, Dr. Saswati Chatterjee, who had originally discovered these, she found them in normal human stem cells. And that's where the HSC comes from. We like the fact that they're naturally occurring because nature, in a sense, had devised these. And the unique thing about AAVs is they're called adeno-associated viruses because they always need to be associated with some other kind of viral infection in order for them to replicate. And so because of that, them themselves as a delivery vehicle are not associated with any known human or animal disease. They're very safe. You can also engineer the inside of these AAVs to deliver genes to liver tissues as well as other key organs or tissues, whatever's going to be important for a particular disease of interest. And there's actually a considerable amount of safety data now on AAVs as we continue to learn how to utilize these to bring these therapies forward. And as of early August of this year, on just looking at clinicaltrials.gov, which is a website that you can go and evaluate and see the different types of clinical trials that are ongoing in the United States, there are roughly 242 of these clinical trials that are ongoing right now. So there's a tremendous amount of knowledge that we're starting to gain on these AAVs. The other aspect that we can think about these AAVs, and this has been known for a long time, is the AAV itself. If you look on here, this is kind of the capsid, if you will. This is the part that really allows you to use these AAVs as a delivery vehicle because cells have receptors on their surface that recognize this capsid. And once it recognizes it, it binds it. And then that capsid, that AAV can actually take the inside, which is what you see here, into the center of the cell, the nucleus of the cell. And what we can do is we can engineer these vectors by having a genome such that they have what's called a promoter. So this is something that the nucleus would recognize and turn on a gene. And then you can put that functioning gene here, this corrective gene. And then once inside the cell, you can see this is what I was referring to as that episome. You can have this episome that sits inside the nucleus. It uses all the same cellular machinery that other genes do. And that it recognizes this promoter and turns on that gene. It makes a transcript, which is called mRNA. That mRNA then goes into the cytoplasm part of the cell and forms a protein. And you can see that it'll form a functional protein, but it really doesn't integrate into the genome. So when you do have a mutated protein, that stays there as well. And in comparison, a gene editing, think about AAVs also, it's the same exact AAV, but what groups have done, including us, we've worked on engineering the inside of those AAVs to not necessarily have a promoter, but to have what are long strands of DNA called homology arms. And during that cell's division, if you have the AAV, can deliver these long single-stranded pieces of DNA into the cell. As that cell's dividing, you can take advantage of a process called homologous recombination. And because of these homology arms, think about them as zip codes. It'll allow you to insert either a full gene or a corrective gene that may change a single amino mutation. It will integrate into that gene. And then as that gene is corrected in the cell, it'll go ahead and make that protein. And then obviously, as I said before, as that cell divides, that correction would still be there. So we've gone on, because these were originally discovered in around 2014, we've gone and characterized these AAVs. And we wanted to understand if you administer them into the bloodstream through an intravenous injection, where do they go? And what we've done, and we actually published this in 2019, we found that they go to a lot of different tissues. And because of that, remember that AAV, it binds to a cell surface, a receptor on the cell surface that can take it in. And what we found is that when we do that, this is an image of a non-human primate where we see after injection, all this brown staining in here, this is actually staining for a protein that we expressed when we injected intravenous. And what this tells us is that in the animal that received the drug, we're seeing expression of that functional gene. And comparison, this image down here is the brain of an animal that did not receive the injection. What's interesting to note here, you see this broad distribution of brown. When we actually go in and investigate very clearly, and I think this is a really important point, when we look across different AAVs, so these HSC 17, 15, and 7, these are just different AAVs, we find that depending on where you are, so this is what's called the lateral geniculate nucleus. This is a specific region in the brain. We find that we get more cells of what are called glia than we do of neurons. And we do get neurons, but it's you can see that it's around 5 to 10% of these neurons. Interestingly, when we look in a different part of the body, and this is in more in the dorsal root ganglion, it's more of a peripheral nerve, you can see here that we get actually the opposite, many more neurons and less glia. So very important as we characterize these to decide how can we target them. And then what you can see over on the right is just a little bit more data really showing that these, in this sense, this green on the right, these are the cells that are expressing the gene that's encoded by that AAV in the CNS of these animals. So how do we utilize that information? And I wanted to put this in. So how do we think about this? If we were even thinking about potentially testing AAVs for a disease like GRN1 deficiency. So AAV HSCs cross the blood-brain barrier. And so the data that I just went over from non-human primates suggest that we can target neurons, which is a very important cell in this disease, but a small fraction of them. But with that, what we can do is we can test and say, can we administer a normal copy of GRN1 to cells in the brain? And this can be tested using a mouse model. There are a couple mouse models that are now become available for GRN1 to administer. And then we can test different things. We can ask certain questions. What percentage of cells can be targeted? And what percentage of those cells that maybe we could target at different doses to have an impact on the phenotype or how the disease manifests within that mouse model? The other question we can ask is gene therapy or gene editing, or maybe even a combination of both? One of the things in thinking about this prior to this seminar is, given the biodistribution data and the fact that these neurons do not divide, a gene therapy approach may be the best way to start first, because you can express a functional copy of GRN1, perhaps overexpress it in those mutations that have gain of function, or in those that don't have any GRN1 whatsoever, to utilize that to express it in that. And you can test that in these animal models. So I don't have any data specifically on GRN1, but I thought I would show just two slides of how we do it with a different type of disease. This disease is called metachromatic leukodystrophy, or MLD. This is an autosomal recessive disorder, and it comes in different forms. And a lot of these diseases come in different forms. The most severe form is this late infantile form, and those are the patients that really have no active enzyme. The cause are mutations in a gene called aryl sulfatase A, or ARSA is a much easier way to say it. And this is a protein. This protein actually works in what a lot of us refer to as kind of the garbage can or the trash can of a cell. It's called the lysosome. And this lysosome is there for a reason, because it can break down different products in the cell. And what happens is this aryl sulfatase A inside that lysosome breaks down what's called sulfatides. And in the disease where you don't have this, this right here, these sulfatides increase, accumulates, and it becomes toxic to the cells, and they can lead to all these different clinical manifestations in children, particularly with this late infantile form. And so how do we go ahead and test that? This is just a little...
I'm just going to jump in to see if we could wrap up so we have some time for questions later. Thank you.
Yep, absolutely. And here we're just showing in a mouse model, we can administer it. It gets into the right cells. Here you can see it in non-human primates, or again, monkeys that we're getting in inadequacies. Pretty colors are the cells that express it. And with those sulfatides, these are the untreated and these are the treated. And we see we can lower those. And so just in summary, I think AAV is being studied for the treatment of monogenic diseases, and these have been shown to cross the blood-brain barrier. And we can really start to consider these as delivery vehicles to deliver genetic medicine. So I will end there so I can turn it over to Dr. Ecker.
Thank you so much, Albert. Our next speaker is Dr. Stephen Ecker. Thank you so much for joining us today. Dr. Ecker is Dean of Mayo Clinic Graduate School of Biomedical Sciences and co-founder of Genome Writer Guild, which is a genome engineering society that aims to push forward genomic engineering technologies in a responsible way and through public education. Dr. Eckert's lab also uses mainly zebrafish as pioneering research organism for gene editing. And he's also deeply involved in mentoring the next generation of scientists. And I'm sure you're anticipating this talk as much as I am. And I'm sure before handing to Steve, a small reminder to post your question in the Q&A section. Thank you so much, and all yours, Steve.
It's great. Can you hear me?
We are good.
Okay, great. Great. Thank you for the opportunity. And I thought I would start with a little bit of a perspective in this space. In 1990, I was a PhD student, and I received a pre-doctoral fellowship from the March of Dimes. And so 30 years ago, and I just want to give perspective. Back then, gene therapy and gene editing was the future of solving rare genetic disease. So I thought we would say, where are we now? But before we start, I thought I'd get some, you know, one key perspective down that's really pretty generic. And then we can, I have a slide that's really as much questions as answers, but let me start. So what is precision genome engineering? So this, well, you may not see it, but this is part of our 3 billion bases that's our genome. And that's precision genome engineering is making specific changes, but at the level, it can be deleting a segment. That's what you're doing here, or replacing that, the green code instead of the black code, or actually at the really precise level, looking at this one A and changing it to a T. And doing so in such a way that would be, for example, correcting a loss of function or an altered allele. And I want you to think of gene editing as a word processor for DNA. So your word processor works as a cursor and a keyboard. And in the case of gene editing, we have cursors, and they're called programmable DNA binding domains. That's their jargon. Here's an example of one class. It's a TALEN. And you have keyboard, but the keyboard is actually the cellular response to the cursor and the biochemistry that's usually a double-stranded break. And the most common keyboard cursor system people use is CRISPR-Cas9. There's a whole series of these, but CRISPR-Cas9 is the most common one used. And there's a whole series of these. As people that think about this, and how quickly, so I've been doing this for 30 years. The last, 5 years has been extraordinary. This is a cost of doing gene editing. So in 2011, I paid $25,008 for a custom zinc finger nucleus, one of these cursors. And it cost me $25,000 to buy it. And it's really at no more than $100 to do it today. So there's this massive cost loss, but then there's also a huge set of new publications and new science. And what you can do with this science is you can turn off genes. That's an example. This is an example where you're turning off a gene that you can see the protein by antibody, and the red cells are gone. Red expressing cells are gone. Or you can use it to add genes, insert code, or knock-ins. And you heard one example that doesn't even use CRISPR-Cas from Dr. Seymour. So fast forward 27 years later, we had the first gene therapy was approved. So, March of Dimes has been an example of an organization really trying to address, genetic diseases. And in 2017, there was actually 3 FDA-approved gene therapies. And the first one was for CAR T cells for a form of leukemia. But I want to get at one of the challenges. So this is the excitement, but the challenge is that approved drug, the cost of goods is $475,000 a patient. We really are thinking hard about what's the next generation is, and that's for one class of disease, right? One, it's actually a quite rare disease overall. So what we're really thinking is, can we come up with more programmable and more accessible CAR T cells or other things, because $475,000 is just not sustainable. And so there are other things you can do, but I do want you to think about gene editing has the ability to think about also simultaneously adding gene function and removing gene function. And so there's really around this idea, what are you doing as if you think about it from editing a word processor of the codes that are, so that's the big concept. I want you to go come across with that, but I want you to think about what are the key questions. So I poked my head in, I listened to, I'm not an expert on the, is it pronounced G-R-I-N? I just sort of grin. This is totally new to me. I am very familiar with lots of rare diseases. Overall, I'm a founding scientist of the Undiagnosed Disease Network International, which has over 30 countries scientists. So there's just lots of, there's 4,000 or more rare diseases. This is an area I have not. But, you know, if you want to do this, do you have the right cargo or genetic cargo, right? And are you targeting the right organs? We actually do mitochondrial disease in my work, and there's a disease called LRP or French Canadian Leigh syndrome, and everybody's been assuming that the neurological defect is the primary. We actually are reasonably sure the liver is actually the primary now with a new set of models. And so we're thinking about targeting the liver instead of the nervous system to indirectly impact the nervous system by removing the problems that are starting at the liver. So these are these ideas, right? Really thinking about the biology, where is it? Because the brain is very hard to modify, although I'm really excited by the data you had, Albert. I really like the new delivery platforms. We have a phrase in gene editing or genome therapy, right? What's the issue? The issue is the three issues. It's, you know, delivery, right? Can you get these things in, right? And then I do want, because of this organization, I really want you to be thinking about the accessibility and making this viable, because there's even a question on different kinds of alleles, right? One therapy might only work for potentially an N equals one patient, right? And so you can't spend 40, you know, set up a four, right now it's $40 million or so to set up a single viral factory for these artificial viruses. And that's count, including you already own the building, okay, for the equipment. That's a December assessment. So are we using the right funding model? You know, that's a publicly traded company, and I think things are great. I'm actually founder of a couple. But I'm wondering whether foundations owning and steering the IP might actually be a better way, for especially for these kinds of personalized precision medicine. So I wanted to get it. It's not just a technology question. That's important, but if it's going to be $500,000 a patient, which might actually be optimistic in many cases, I don't know how accessible it's going to be. So I worry about these kinds of things. So I'm really happy to chat more about this. Encourage you to connect with the Genome Writers Guild itself. We just had a conference on next generation therapies in July, really trying to wrestle with these kinds of challenges, scientific, cultural, accessible, how are we actually going to make these all happen? So we're living in exciting times. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Stephen. That was amazing. We have a few questions here. The first one is, can gene therapy be considered for dominant negative disease models at higher doses or not? I don't know who would like to start answering that question.
I think it's a question that's going to be specific for each particular disease. It's definitely it's something that could be a challenge in the cells you would really have to overexpress it to a point that you could swamp out, if you will, the dominant negative effect. It's certainly testable. I'm not aware of any clinical trials that are ongoing with dominant negative type disorders, but it's something that we've and the community has actually discussed. To see if you could overexpress it enough to overcome that dominant negative effect.
Okay, great, thank you. The next question is about research organism. Are there any non-human primate models with green mutations that can be useful for testing gene therapy editing approaches?
I'm not aware of any. Non-human primate models are challenging for a number of reasons, because you do need a lot of animals to test these. And so primates are, you know, they have maybe, you know, they have one offspring each pregnancy. So it's and it takes a long time. So it's challenging. I know that Some groups are looking at other types of large animal species, but as far as the GRIN specific mutations in primates, I am not aware of any.
Yeah, does it need to be a non-human primate? I mean, there are large animal models like pigs that are extraordinarily programmable for making new disease models. They grow quickly. And they have a lot of the physiology that's very similar.
That's great, thank you. This question, I know that you, Stephen, also touched upon this in your talk. Lots of our GRIN1 kids have common features in addition to their neurological and GI muscular issues, smooth skin, low weight, lustrous hair, for example. How can gene therapy editing be sure to target only the cells that need the amendment?
Yeah, it's a question, right? It's a biological question. It's not just a technological question. The one thing that we've learned in our mitochondrial disease space, which has a lot of neurological outcomes, is that everybody seems to be pointing to the neurons, but I'm not sure the neurons, I think the neurons have a lot of ability to compensate. When multiple legs get pulled out from underneath them, then they have their problems. And I think there's abilities to shore up the support in other parts of organ systems like the liver. And I think it's really around understanding the biology. And this is hard, right? Because these are rare diseases, have really specific phenotypes. And so, you know, engaging the biology so that you know what's going on is really critical. It is part of the hard question for gene therapy.
And linked to that, probably for you, Albert, are AAVHCs superior to AAV9 for central nervous system delivery?
It's a really good question. So the AAVHSCs are what are called in the same family as AAV9, so they share a lot of similar properties. One of the things that we've done in characterizing them is AAV9 is one, and then there are 15 that we're characterizing. What we find, and it was in that publication, is that even a one amino acid difference can lead to subtle differences in what percentage of cells get transduced or even what type of cells. So it depends on the question that you're asking. That would be around what particular cell are you interested in. If you have 16, so 15 AAVHSCs plus AAV9, you may want to look at all of them and figure out for your particular cell which one is going to give you the maximum benefit based on what you're trying to do. But that one amino acid is really interesting, that it can make a big difference.
Great, thank you. Mm-hmm. And then another question, published work on GRIN2B showed probable toxicity of the mutated proteins to the brain. For this reason, wouldn't it be ideal to think about gene editing instead of gene therapy?
Yeah, that's the mechanism, right? If the clinical manifestation is from the altered form, right? That's actually ideal for gene editing. I would use microhomology MMBJ base, so you can have up to 100% of the time the outcome is what you want. And you just have to deliver it with the right vector. I mean, I think these are those things, right? But how many patients, right, is that, right? I mean, I'm not going to go back to it's not a scientific problem. I'm going to get back. I really believe a lot of this includes the scenario of where does the funding come from and how do you do it? But I think you can. I think we can invert the model, right? You can invert the model where a patient comes in and then a therapy comes out, right? And so the question is to do that is going to require foundations and other advocacy groups that are inverting the financial model. And there would be partners with companies like Homology. I really believe that's the solution for rare diseases.
Thank you so much. This has been an amazing session. Thank you so much for sharing your expertise. Thank you everybody for being present. And the questions are gonna be delivered if you have more questions, to the speaker. Thank you so much and enjoy the rest of the conference.
Thank you.